am live. I'm not really sure. You can never really tell with YouTube. It's like live, but not live, or isn't, or something like that. Anyway, you can never tell when it starts because you try to be live and things have to connect and stuff like that. Anyway, howdy everybody. Welcome to another episode of White Paper Wednesday. It's the show every Wednesday when I read through a white paper or some literature that maybe you haven't read through. I make it easier for you by reading through it myself, and commenting on it as I go along so you can understand it. Anyway, I got a really interesting paper for you today. It is Nick Szabo's Bit Gold. This was actually published in 2005, and it's nice. It was referred to in Satoshi Nakamoto's white paper, and for that reason, it has some reasonable, it could be seen reasonably as sort of like a precedent. Anyway, yeah, so I'm gonna read through this, but before I do, please, please, please click like and subscribe to my channel if you haven't. That way I know that this is content that you guys want. I don't really do this for the money or anything. I just want to know that there are people watching this. So if you are watching this and you appreciate it, please click like and subscribe. All right, anyway, here is the paper. It's available on nakamotoinstitute.org. And basically it's from Nick Szabo. It's called Bit Gold. It was published December 29, 2005, which is 15 years ago. Kind of crazy. All right, so here we go. A long time ago, I hit upon the idea of Bit Gold. The problem, in a nutshell, is that our money currently depends on trust in a third party for its value. As many inflationary and hyperinflationary episodes during the 20th century demonstrated, this is not an ideal state of affairs. Similarly, private bank note issue, while it had various advantages as well as disadvantages, similarly depend on a trusted third party. So, Nick's reason for writing this is so that we can remove this trusted third party, which is very reminiscent of what's in the Satoshi white paper and why Satoshi called it cash. Precious metals and collectibles have an unforgeable scarcity due to the costliness of their creation. This once provided money the value of which was largely independent of any trusted third party. Precious metals have problems, however. It's too costly to assay metals repeatedly for common transactions. Thus, a trusted third party, usually associated with a tax collector who accepts the coins as payment, was invoked to stamp a standard amount of the metal into a coin. Transporting large values of metal can be a rather insecure affair, as the British found when transporting gold across a U-boat invested Atlantic to Canada during World War I to support their gold standard. What's worse, you can't pay online with metal. So the fact that it's physical, that it has, it's hard to know how much is in gold. You have to weigh it all the time, or you have to try, means that usually you end up with a third party that's trusted. Sometimes a bank, but oftentimes a government who mint the coins and give it a standard weight and so on. Thus, it would be very nice if there were a protocol whereby unforgeably costly bits could be created online with minimal dependence on trusted third parties and then securely stored, transferred, and assayed with similar minimal trust, bit gold. My proposal for bit gold is based on computing a string of bits from a string of challenge bits using functions called variously. Client puzzle function, proof of work function, or secure benchmark function. So we can already sort of see that there's already this idea that using computational power can be a way to create some sort of a challenge. Now, with Bitcoin, it's a little different, but it's a really interesting idea here. The resulting string of bits is the proof of work, where a one-way function is prohibitively difficult to compute backwards. A secure benchmark function ideally comes with a specific cost measured in compute cycles to compute backwards. So, he's thinking more along the lines, I think, of using like various proofs of work as like different different amounts. So little proof of work would be like a nickel, but a lot of proof of work would be like $1 million. Here are the main steps of the BitGold system that I envision. A public string of bits, the challenge string, is created. Step 5. Alice on her computer generates the proof of work string from the challenge bits using a benchmark function. The proof of work is securely timestamped. This should work in a distributed fashion with several different timestamp services so that no particular timestamp service need be substantially relied on. Alice adds the challenge string and the timestamp proof of work string to a distributed property title registry for BitGold. Here too, no single server is substantially relied on to properly operate the registry. The last created string of BitGold provides the challenge bits for the next created string. To verify that Alice is the owner of a particular string of BitGold, Bob checks the unforgeable chain of title in the BitGold title registry. To say the value of a string of BitGold, Bob checks and verifies the challenge bits, the proof of work string, and the timestamp. So he is actually describing Bitcoin pretty well, actually, right? Like you have proof of work, so some challenge bits, it's a little bit different because there's several timestamp services instead of like everyone running their own node, but the distributed property title registry is essentially what we call in Bitcoin the blockchain. This is where all of the here's how much each public key owns and so on. Note that Alice's control over her BitGold does not depend on her sole possession of the bits, but rather on her lead position in the unforgeable chain of title, chain of digital signatures in the title registry. All of this can be automated by software. The main limits to the security of the scheme are how well trust can be distributed in steps 3 and 4. Remember, 3 and 4 is the this is the actual timestamping, which is what a blockchain does, and the actual ledger, which is the distributed title registry. Hal Finney has implemented a variant of BitGold called RPOW, Reusable Proof of Work. This relies on publishing the computer code for the mint, which runs on a remote tamper-evident computer. The purchaser of a BitGold can then use remote attestation, which Finney calls the transparent server technique, to verify that a particular number of cycles were actually performed. So based on the difficulty, you can verify, that it's it was that much work went into it. The main problem with all these schemes is that proof of work seems to depend on computer architecture, not just an abstract mathematics based on an abstract computer cycle. I wrote about this obscurely several years ago. Thus, it might be possible to be a very low cost producer by several orders of magnitude and swamp the market with BitGold. Right, so this is the problem essentially of something like ASICs, which can produce proof of work very easily if you had sort of like a standard. And I think that's what Nick was thinking when he wrote this, was that, okay, well, if you have, if you have a particular proof of work, it's easier on one architecture versus another. However, since BitGold is timestamped, the time created as well as the mathematical difficulty of the work can be automatically proven. From this, it can usually be inferred what the cost of producing during that time period was. So this is sort of like, okay, well, it should be worth this much because it costs that much electricity to produce. It's the unforgeable scarcity, which was designed essentially from the beginning. And this is an important point about proof of work. If it's easily forgeable, then it's not really money. If it's too easy to produce, then it's easy money. What Nick's talking about here is hard money, and I believe that Satoshi felt the same way, which is why proof of work exists in Bitcoin. Unlike fungible atoms of gold, but as with collector's items, a large supply during a given time period will drive down the value of those particular items. In this respect, BitGold acts more like a collector's item than like gold. However, the match between this ex post market and the auction determining the initial value might create a very substantial profit for the Bitgold miner who invests and deploys an optimized computer architecture. So I think he's thinking like, you know, you issue the challenge and whoever meets the challenge gets to print. And that's obviously not how Bitcoin works, but that's that was Nick's vision in this paper. Thus, Bitgold will not be fungible based on a simple function of, for example, the length of the string. Instead, to create fungible units, dealers will have to combine different value pieces of Bitgold into larger units of approximately equal value. This is analogous to what many commodity dealers do today to make commodity markets possible. Trust is still distributed because the estimated values of such bundles can be independently verified by many other parties in a large or entirely automated fashion. So essentially, he's already thinking about privacy and fungibility and making sure that, you know, one thing isn't distinguishable from another. And he's talking about commodity dealers, and yeah, it's essentially the same things that we're talking about with CoinJoin. In summary, all money mankind has ever used has been insecure in one way or another. The insecurity has been manifested in a wide variety of ways, from counterfeiting to theft, but the most pernicious of which has probably been inflation. Bitgold may provide us with a money of unprecedented security from these dangers. The potential for initially hidden supply gluts due to hidden innovations in machine architecture is a potential flaw in Bitgold, or at least an imperfection which the initial auctions and ex post exchanges of Bitgold will have to address. So it's interesting because this was definitely addressed with the with the difficulty adjustment algorithm. This is the innovation that Satoshi Nakamoto saw that Nick didn't in this paper, which is that if you adjust the difficulty algorithm after a certain number of blocks, then you don't have a supply glut, and you can have a fixed supply, which is something I think Nick didn't see in this paper, or didn't see a way to do in this paper. So that is Bitgold, and it's surprisingly very, very close to what Bitcoin is. The main thing missing is the difficulty adjustment and having a fixed supply and things like that. Those are not in this paper, but a lot of the other stuff, having a ledger, proof of work, using computer power to compute proof of work, and so on, it's all in there. Even stuff like coin joins are sort of in its conceptual form in this paper. So it was a fairly short read, but it was a very significant paper for a reason. It really did have a lot of the ideas that Satoshi Nakamoto took and put into the Bitcoin white paper, and also a reason why a lot of people think Nick Szabo is Satoshi. Anyway, that is about it. It was a short show. We do have the halving coming up. And, you know, like, things are happening with price, as you can see. I know I don't normally do price and stuff like that. I do have tones like indicator here, and I could, you know, I have the 50 period moving average and the 200 period moving average, which are doing some interesting things. But we did have this pop. The long-term trend line is the one that would need to break in order for us to go higher. This long-term trend line starts in December 2017, and we keep hitting it, and we keep touching on it. So I don't know, maybe we bust past it right in time for the halving, in which case I think there isn't that much resistance going upwards, and you know, we could see an all-time high in a few months or something like that, but who knows. I'm not a trader, so it's but I do like to draw lots of lines and stuff. All right, so that is about it for today. I could talk about I already talked about the stock to flow model, that's Plan B's thing, and maybe I'll have him on the show sometime or have a conversation with him, but not right now. All right, anyway, that's it for the show. I don't see any questions in the chat. So that means fiat delenda.